Welcome to this meeting of the Science Alliance.
And I'm Judy. We're going to start the show with a riddle. What's invisible and all around us?
Air!
Right. And that's what we're going to be talking about today.
Okay, Bryant, while we go inside, tell us what our first question is.
All right, Rex. Z writes, if we can't see air, how do we know that air takes up space?
Emma placed a funnel in the jar and stuffed plasticine in the neck. Let's see what happens when you pour water into the jar, Emma. Well, what happens?
The water's not going into the jar.
Two things can't be in the same place at the same time, so air must be taking up space in the jar. Jeff, give the air a way to come out. When the air is able to come out, the water can go in.
We asked some members of the Science Alliance to find some places where air takes up space. All right, Rula, what's your experiment?
I'm going to put water in this glass where there's sand.
All right, why don't you do that? All right. Now, what's happening?
Bubbles.
There are bubbles coming up from the sand. Kostas, what did you do?
Well, I put some water in here about a couple of hours ago, and I came back and I looked in it and I saw bubbles.
Yeah, there are small bubbles that have formed on the inside of the glass. Mark, tell me about your experiment.
Well, my experiment is to put this sponge into the glass of water.
All right. Now, what's happening with the sponge?
There's bubbles coming out.
Yeah, there are bubbles around the sponge and also coming out of it. You can try doing this experiment yourself using different materials. Most materials have spaces between the particles. Where there are large spaces, you'll have larger bubbles of air. Air is almost everywhere. Larry asks our second question, what happens when air is heated?
In our program on heat, we showed you that air, like most matter, expands when it is heated. Here's something else that happens, but don't try this yourself. Watch. When air is heated, it rises. And we use this property to make the plastic bag rise. Like a balloon.
Thank you. That's my first word. And that means it's time for Bryant's Science of Science. A long time ago, Joseph Montgolfier was sitting in front of his fireplace watching the fire. Suddenly, he had an idea. Bring me a silk handkerchief, he told his maid. When the maid returned with the handkerchief, he twisted it around and made a small bag. Carefully, he held the open bag over the fire, catching the heat and smoke. Then, when the bag was full, he let it go. The bag began to rise in the air until it hit the ceiling of the room. This is only the beginning, Joseph Montgolfier said. Together with his brother Etienne, Joseph made a large balloon out of silk. Then they built a bonfire and held the open end of the balloon over the flames. The balloon began to fill with hot air. When the silk looked ready to burst, the brothers released the balloon. Up it went, up until it rose almost a kilometer in the sky. Soon, everyone in France had heard of the Montgolfier brothers and their floating balloon. Even King Louis XVI.
I want to see this for myself, the king told the brothers. Make a bigger balloon and bring it to my court.
Joseph and Etienne went to the king's court at Versailles. They had built a huge balloon out of reinforced linen and attached a basket to the bottom. A bonfire was built and the balloon was slowly filled with hot air. The brothers held the balloon on the ground with ropes. When the balloon was full, they placed a duck, a rooster, and a sheep in the basket. Cut the ropes, they ordered. And up the balloon floated. For 8 minutes, the balloon floated on the air and traveled over 2 kilometers from the court. Soon, balloons were floating all over Europe. But they didn't just carry animals. They carried people, too. Bryant salutes the Montgolfier brothers, who invented the hot air balloon and truly two great giants of science.
Thank you, Bryant. People still use hot air balloons today. And the reason they work is that hot air rises.
Our next question is from Darcy, and she writes, you've said that air is all around us, but what is air? Well, that's a good question, Darcy. Air is made up of different things. There's air inside this bag. We can't see it because air is invisible. Sometimes we think we can see air, but actually we're seeing the particles of matter that are in the air. The other day, I placed a piece of paper coated with grease outside this window. Now remember, it was clean and clear when I placed it outside. Take a look at it. It's covered with specks of dust. That's because there's dust in the air.
Here's another experiment with air. A few days ago, I put some wet steel wool in the bottom of this test tube. I placed both test tubes upside down in a beaker of water. What happened? The steel wool has rusted, and some of the water has moved up the test tube. That means that some of the air is missing, and that part of the air has joined with the iron in the steel wool to form rust. The scientific name for rust is iron oxide. That's because oxygen joins with the iron to form rust. So there must have been oxygen in the air. About one-fifth of the air is missing from the test tube. That's because about one-fifth of air is oxygen.
A few hours ago, I placed a glass outside the window. Now, the glass was dry, and it's very cold outside. Where are the droplets of water coming from? Right, the air. The cold glass is cooling the air around it. When air is cooled enough, some of the gases in the air change to liquid. This change of state is known as condensation. Now, water as a gas is known as water vapor. This demonstration shows there's water vapor in the air.
But there are other gases in the air as well. About 3/4 of the air is nitrogen. And then there's argon, carbon dioxide, neon, helium, krypton, methane, nitrous oxide, hydrogen, and xenon. These gases are found in our air naturally. But we also release gases into the air through pollution. Where there's lots of air pollution, you might find carbon monoxide or sulfur dioxide. Our next question comes from Vincent. He wants to know, what is air pressure?
There's air on this part of the card. Remember that we found out that air has mass? At sea level, the mass of air pressing down against 1 square centimeter of the Earth's surface is about 1 kilogram. We measure air pressure using a barometer. And air pressure is measured in pascals.
Thank you. That was my second word. And that means it's time for Bryant's Science of Science. Blaise Pascal was studying air pressure for many years. He knew that air pressure pushed mercury up the glass tube of a barometer. But was air pressure the same everywhere, Pascal wondered. He had tried the experiment in his house, which was at sea level. What would happen if he tested his barometer someplace higher? He asked his brother to help him, and together they climbed to the top of the tallest building in town. When they reached the top, Pascal looked at the barometer. It was almost the same as the measurement in the street, maybe a fraction lower. This isn't good enough, Pascal said. I have to test the barometer at sea level and someplace very high, like a mountain. Pascal and his brother took 2 barometers to the foot of a mountain in France. His brother stayed at the bottom of the mountain and every hour measured the air pressure. Pascal took his barometer and climbed the mountain. Slowly he climbed. Every hour he stopped and checked the barometer. Pascal's barometer was changing. But what about his brother's? The 2 brothers checked their notes. Pascal's barometer had dropped as he climbed higher up the mountain, but his brother's barometer had stayed the same. Height had affected air pressure. Bryant salutes Blaise Pascal, who proved that air pressure changes with height. And truly, a great giant of science.
Thanks, Bryant. So Blaise Pascal found out that there is less air pressure as we go higher, because there's less air pressing down on us. Well, let's test that out. I have a barometer, and it reads 101 kilopascals. Watch.
Welcome to the CN Tower, the world's tallest freestanding structure. From the ground to the top, the elevator travels 350 meters straight up at a speed of 60 meters per second. And here we are. Thank you for flying CN.
The barometer registers only 97 kilopascals. The air pressure is lower because there is less air pressing down on the barometer.
I'm pressing on this foam ball in one direction, down. But air presses in all directions. Watch. I'll place a card on this flask filled with water. As I said, air presses in all directions, upwards, sideways, and down. In this demonstration, the air pressure on the outside of the card is greater than the water pressure on the inside of the flask, so the water stays in the flask. We don't feel air pressure on our bodies because the air pressure on the inside is equal to the air pressure on the outside. But what happens if the air pressure on the outside is greater than on the inside? Let's find out. Chad is heating the air inside the bottle. Some of the air is rising and escaping. Let's cap the bottle so no more air can enter or escape. This will take a while, so we'll speed up the tape so we can watch the whole process. As the bottle cools, the air inside it contracts, resulting in less air pressure on the inside of the bottle than on the outside. As you can see, air presses in all directions.
Here's our last question about air. Abby wants to know, can air be used to do work?
In our show about machines, we found out that work is done when something is moved. Earlier in this program, we used hot air to move something, and air pressure crushed this bottle. So the answer to Abby's question is yes, air can do work. Here's another example. When I turn on this fan, it causes the air in front of it to move. And it moves the pinwheel. So the air does work.
Here's another example of air doing work. As Stephanie sucks in, she lowers the air pressure in the straw. So now the air pressure on the grape juice in the glass is greater than the air pressure on the grape juice in the straw. So air does work because the juice moves up the straw.
Here are some more things you might like to find out about air. Why are soap bubbles round?
Why did the pencil break? There are many ways to find out the answers to our questions, and there are many more things you might like to find out about air.
Before we see you at our next meeting of the Science Alliance, find out all you can by experimenting, reading books, and talking to people. Bye.
Bye-bye.
There's not that much soap in it.